Morning, beloved. Well, this morning we're going to bring to a close our study in the book of Colossians. And I'd like to invite you to open your Bibles to Colossians chapter 4, our scripture reading. Again, you have an outline in your bulletin that you can follow along and jot some notes. And this morning we're going to look at Paul's final exhortations and final greetings to the church in Colossae as he brings this epistle to a close. So let's have a word of prayer and ask the Lord to once again speak to us through his word. Let's pray. Father, thank you for, again, your presence with us here this morning. Thank you for the opportunity to sing praises to your name and to worship you and to give you glory. And Lord, now we thank you for the book of Colossians and the many wonderful truths that we've been learning in this marvelous epistle. And Lord, as we now look at the end of chapter 4, we ask once again that you might speak to our hearts and our minds, enable us by your Spirit to understand what Paul wrote, what it means, and how it applies to our life today. And then, Lord, help us to live our lives in light of its truths, so that our lives would be pleasing and glorifying in your sight. We thank you for these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, we saw way back in our introduction to Colossians that Epaphras, who was the leader in the church in Colossae, had gone to Rome, where Paul was in prison under house arrest, and told him about the church in Colossae, a church that Paul had never been to. And in response, Paul wrote this letter to the Colossians. And in the beginning, we saw in chapter 1 that he had greeted them with his normal greeting that he did in his letters. He expressed gratitude for their faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, because Epaphras had told Paul about the Colossians and their salvation. And then he prayed for them. He prayed for their spiritual growth, that they would grow in their knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ, that they would grow in their walk with him to have a Christ-like character. And then after this introduction, we saw the second part of the book at the end of chapter 1, a highly doctrinal section where Paul wrote about the preeminence of Jesus Christ. He described the Lord Jesus Christ and gave seven characteristics of who the Lord Jesus Christ is. We looked at that. He wrote about the reconciliation ministry by Christ, how though we had alienated ourselves from God, we can be reconciled to God through the death of the Lord Jesus Christ and faith in him. And then Paul wrote about his ministry of reconciliation, how he preached the gospel, the good news, that we could be reconciled to God through Jesus Christ. And Paul preached Christ. He warned every man and taught every man in all wisdom, with the goal being that he might present every man mature and perfect in the Lord Jesus. And that's what the ministry is all about. And after talking about and writing about the preeminence of Christ and his reconciliation ministry, Paul then exhorted the Colossians and us to grow in Christ. We've been rooted in him. We've been grounded into him. And so we need to continue to grow in him through his word, not man-made philosophy, not Jewish legalism of following the Mosaic law, not mystical teaching and mystical experiences, and not asceticism. Those things do not help you grow. That's not what we are to do as believers. We need to grow in Christ. And then after that, Paul moved into the highly practical part of the book, where he talked about our conduct if Christ is preeminent in our life. And we saw that Christ has to be preeminent in our thinking. We have to set our minds on things above and not things on the earth. We saw that we need to put off and to put to death all the sinful things that might be in our life left over from before we were saved. And we need to put on Jesus Christ, put on love and kindness and humility, and be like him. And we saw piety in the home and the responsibilities of husbands and wives and children and parents and slaves and masters. And we saw how we are to conduct ourselves in the home or at work in a way that is pleasing to God and to glorify Him. And so now, as we come to the final section of the book in chapter 4, verses 2 to 18, we see Paul's final exhortations and then his final greetings as he brings this letter to a close. Let's look first of all at verses 2 to 6, where Paul is going to exhort the Colossians concerning prayer and their witness toward unbelievers. Okay, we'll look at prayer in verses 2 to 4, and then witness to unbelievers in verses 5 and 6. By the way, you might notice I put the wrong verses on your outline. The prayer is actually verses 2 to 4, and the witness to unbelievers is verses 5 to 6. So you might want to jot that in your outline there. Well, let's look first of all at the prayer. And what Paul does as he exhorts the Colossians in verses 2 to 4 about prayer, first he exhorts them about prayer generally speaking, and then he gets very specific and he asks for a prayer request for himself and for those with him. So let's see Paul's final exhortation about prayer in verses 2 to 4. Let's look first of all at verse 2. He writes this: "Continue steadfastly in prayer, being watchful in it with thanksgiving." And so here Paul writes that generally speaking, as believers in the Lord Jesus Christ and as a church, we need to be steadfast, to continue in prayer. And you know, I don't know about you, but I find that to be a very difficult thing. I find it very difficult to continue steadfastly in my own private prayer life and in corporate prayer with the church. And by the way, I'll make a plug for this Friday night. We have our prayer rally. And I want to encourage all of you to join us Friday night as we come together to continue steadfastly in prayer as a church. And so Paul writes that as believers, we need to be steadfast in our prayer. And he writes that we need to be watchful in it. In other words, be aware of what's going on at church, at work, in your home, and what needs to be prayed for. People that need to be prayed for. Things that need to be prayed for. And so we need to be watchful. We need to be alert. And we need to be sure that we're not living in our own little world, in our own little bubble, and we're not aware of what's going on around us and the prayer needs of others. And so Paul says, be steadfast in prayer. Be watchful in it with thanksgiving. Again, continually as we pray with the attitude of thanksgiving to the Lord for all of His goodness to us and all that He has done for us. And so this general exhortation to prayer, he also gave to the Ephesians. In Ephesians 6:18, do you remember when we studied this, the four alls of prayer? He said, praying at, number one, all times in the Spirit, with all prayer, number two, and supplication. To that end, keep alert with all perseverance, making supplication for all the saints. And so again, Paul wrote to the Ephesians basically the same thing that he wrote to the Colossians, that we as believers need to be praying at all times in the Spirit, that we need to be consistent and steadfast in prayer with all supplication. Keep alert, being watchful in it, persevering and making supplication for all the saints. And so, beloved, individually as believers, and corporately as a church, we need to be steadfast, watchful, and thankful in our prayer lives. And that's a struggle. That it really is. We have to fight for that time to set apart, to spend time in prayer with the Lord alone, but also we need to make the effort to join together corporately to pray together as a church. And so, generally, he says, be steadfast, watchful, and thankful. But now in verses 3 to 4, he gets very specific. And he asks them a prayer request for himself. And verse 3 says this. At the same time, okay, while you're being steadfast and watchful and thankful, at the same time, pray also for us, Paul and those with him. He says that God may open to us a door for the word of God to declare the mystery of Christ, on account of which I am in prison, that I may make it clear, which is how I ought to speak. You know, it's interesting. If I was in prison, I would probably ask prayer request that I be released. But Paul doesn't pray that. He doesn't ask for release. He doesn't ask for his personal comforts. He asks for an open door to preach the gospel. He says, pray for us that God will open a door for the word of God, that the word of God and the gospel message might be preached. The mystery of Christ. All those truths about the Messiah that were not revealed in the Old Testament, but now were revealed through the Lord Jesus Christ and to the apostles. He says, pray that I might have an open door, that I might preach the gospel. And he says, on account of which I'm in prison. That's why Paul was there. That's why he was arrested, because of his preaching the gospel. So he prays for an open door, an opportunity to preach. And he says, that I may make it clear. Paul says, pray that when I preach the gospel, it is clear, it is understandable, that people grasp the meaning and the truth of the gospel, and that it changes their life. And one thing that we're dedicated to here at GCF East is to endeavor to make the word of God as clear and as understandable as possible, so that all of us will have a clear understanding of what the Word of God says, what it means, and how it applies to our life to live it. And that's what Paul requested, prayer for an open door to preach, and that when he preaches it, he makes it clear and understandable for those that heard. Again, he asked the same thing in Ephesians chapter 6, verses 19 and 20. When he asked for a specific prayer for himself to the Ephesians, he writes, and also for me, that words may be given to me in opening my mouth boldly to proclaim the mystery of the gospel, for which I am an ambassador in chains, that I may declare it boldly as I ought to speak. So again, Paul prayed that he might make the gospel clear, and that he might proclaim it with boldness, with boldness. And so specifically, we need to be praying that God would give us open doors for the gospel as a church and individually, and we need to be praying for boldness and the ability to make it clear and understandable so that people will grow in their understanding of the Lord. So in verses 2 to 4, here in Ephesians 4, Paul encourages them and exhorts them to prayer generally and specific requests for him. But now in verses 5 to 6, Paul writes about their witness to unbelievers. The Colossians, just like you and I, we live in a world of unbelievers. We go to work, we go to school, we go to our homes, we go to our neighborhoods. And we are surrounded by and we interact with unbelievers. How should we act? How should we talk? And Paul gives them a brief exhortation concerning their witness to unbelievers in verses 5 and 6. Let's look first of all at verse 5. He says, walk in wisdom toward outsiders. That's referring to unbelievers. Making the best use of the time, or redeeming the time. And so, beloved, when we deal with and interact with unbelievers in our life, we need to do that wisely. We should not deal with them and interact with them in a foolish way that might unnecessarily turn them off to the gospel. If the gospel turns them off, that's their problem. But if our presentation is not wise, then it's our problem. And he says we need to walk in wisdom toward them, and we need to redeem the time. Make the most of our opportunities. In other words, when you are around unbelievers, make the most of the opportunity to witness to them, both through your behavior and your speech and your conduct. The Lord Jesus put it this way in Matthew 10, verse 16, as he was sending out the apostles two by two to go out and to preach the gospel. He says, "Behold, I'm sending you out as sheep in the midst of what? Wolves." Beloved, you're the sheep. And when you go to work or you're with unbelievers, they're the wolves. And so he says, "I'm sending you out as sheep in the midst of wolves. So be wise as serpents and harmless or innocent as doves." And so we need to walk in such a way with unbelievers that they see our light and glorify God, and that we don't do anything or say anything that hinders our witness to them. And so we need to walk in wisdom. And sometimes we make mistakes in our dealings with unbelievers, but we need to learn from them and grow through them and be a better witness later on. So Paul writes, first of all, that our walk, our conduct, our behavior needs to be with wisdom, making most of the opportunities. But then in verse 6, he talks about our speech toward an unbeliever. When you go to work tomorrow and you are surrounded by unbelievers, what kind of speech should you have? What kind of talk? He says in verse 6, "Let your speech," again, toward unbelievers, "always be" what? "Gracious." Gracious. "Seasoned with salt, so that you may know how you ought to answer," each person. So when we interact with unbelievers, our speech should be gracious, understanding they're lost. All right? We don't want to pound them over the head with the Bible, figuratively speaking, through our speech, or be, you know, condemning and attack them for sinful behavior or speech. No, we are to be gracious toward them. Yes, we are to speak the truth in love and never justify sinful behavior, but our presentation should be gracious. He puts "seasoned with salt," just as salt is a preservative and gives flavor. So our speech should have that same effect toward an unbeliever, that we might answer them in such a way that glorifies God and will possibly win them to Christ. Peter wrote the same thing in 1 Peter 3:15. A verse, again, about believers and our speech toward unbelievers. He says, "But in your hearts, honor Christ the Lord as holy." Okay? Set apart the Lord in your hearts. "Always being prepared to make a defense." All right? "To who?" "To anyone who asks you for a reason for the hope that is in you, but yet do it with" what? "Gentleness and respect." You see, as we interact with unbelievers, sometimes they're going to come and say, "Well, what is it about you Christians? You know, or what do you think about this? Or what do you believe about that?" And he says, we need to be ready. We need to be prepared to give a defense of our faith. All right? But when we do that, we need to do it with gentleness and respect. Gentleness and respect. Because sometimes our graciousness and our respect and our presentation, they might not accept right away what we tell them, but our demeanor and the way we share with them will have an impact on their life, and the Lord can use that. And so, beloved, we need to walk with wisdom toward unbelievers in our conduct, in our behavior, and make sure that our speech with them is gracious, gentle, because, again, that will have an effect on them. The Lord can use that to draw them to Him. So these are Paul's final exhortations to the Colossians concerning prayer and concerning their witness to unbelievers. Now in verses 7 to 18, we find Paul's concluding personal remarks. He's starting to bring the letter to a close now, and he's going to send greetings to them from some of the people that are with him in Rome, and just some final remarks, right? Let's look at the first one in verses 7 to 8, and this concerns the man who carried the letter, Tychicus. We studied about Tychicus when we were in our introduction. Verses 7 and 8, Paul writes this: Tychicus will tell you all about my activities. He is a beloved brother and faithful minister and fellow servant in the Lord. I have sent him to you for this very purpose, that you may know how we are and that he may encourage your hearts. And so Tychicus is the man who carried this letter, and Paul says when he gets there, he will tell you all about our activities. He would give them an update on Paul's situation in Rome, the open door for preaching that he had there as people came to visit him, about his trial. And notice the three things that Paul writes about Tychicus. What a great commendation that Paul gave to this man. He said, number one, he's a beloved brother. He's a beloved brother in the Lord, loved by Paul, brother in the Lord Jesus Christ. Secondly, he's a faithful minister. Tychicus had traveled with Paul for quite a while, and he faithfully served with Paul in the ministry. He was a, number three, a fellow servant in the Lord, a fellow servant of Paul in his ministry for the Lord Jesus Christ. We first read about Tychicus in Acts chapter 20, verse 4. In Acts chapter 20, verse 4, this is on the last missionary journey. Remember, Paul was in Corinth to collect the offering for the saints, and he's on his way to Jerusalem. He's in Corinth, and he's about to leave to go to Jerusalem. And in Acts chapter 20, verse 4, it tells us that Sopater the Berean, son of Pyrrhus, accompanied him. So Sopater accompanied Paul. And of the Thessalonians, Aristarchus and Secundus. Now, keep that in mind. Aristarchus was a Thessalonian. We'll see him in a moment. And Gaius of Derbe and Timothy and the Asians, Tychicus and Trophimus. So Tychicus was an Asian, that's the Roman province of Asia in what is today Turkey. Perhaps he was an Ephesian, we don't know, but he was from the Roman province of Asia. And here it first mentions Tychicus as one who accompanied Paul from Corinth to go to Jerusalem to deliver the offering. And now here we are a couple of years later, and Tychicus is with Paul in Rome. And he's a faithful brother, a faithful servant, beloved brother. And Paul is going to send Tychicus to Colossae and carry the letter. And so he says, when Tychicus gets there, he'll give you an update. He'll tell you everything that's going on. And notice the two purposes for which Paul sent Tychicus. It wasn't just to deliver the letter. Verse 8 says this: I have sent him to you for this very purpose, number one, that you may know how we are. And so Paul wanted the Colossians to know how he and Epaphras and the others were doing in Rome. But notice the second reason: and that he may encourage your hearts. Tychicus, as a faithful minister, would go to Colossae and he would encourage them. He would encourage them through giving him the update of Paul. He would encourage them through delivering this letter of encouragement, and he would encourage them by his own presence, by his own ministry in their lives. And so Tychicus, this godly man, delivered the letter. He gave the Colossians an update on Paul, and he encouraged their hearts. I think I mentioned to you in my introduction that I had decided not to name any of my sons Tychicus. Tychicus Ibrahim. It just doesn't sound very good, I don't think. But anyway, well, Tychicus had a kasama, or kaoban, as we say down south. Tychicus had a companion as he left Rome and carried this letter along with Ephesians and Philemon to go to Colossae. And he talks about and writes about the kasama, the companion of Tychicus in delivering this letter. In verse 9, Paul writes this, "And with him, the one coming with Tychicus, is Onesimus, our faithful and beloved brother, who is one of you. They will tell you of everything that has taken place here." And so here Paul writes that Onesimus, and notice how he describes him, a faithful and beloved brother who is one of you. Onesimus was a Colossian. But as we know from the book of Philemon, he was actually a slave of Philemon who stole from Philemon and ran away to Rome, but then met up with the apostle Paul, who led him to Christ. And so now Paul was sending Onesimus back to Colossae, back to Philemon, as a faithful and beloved brother, so that Onesimus with Tychicus would tell the Colossians all about Paul and his circumstances. We read about Onesimus in the book of Philemon, first in verses 10 to 12. Paul writing to Philemon, who was again the owner of Onesimus when Onesimus ran away. He says, "I appeal to you for my child, his spiritual child, Onesimus, whose father I became in my imprisonment. Formerly he was useless to you, but now he is indeed useful to you and to me, and I am sending him back to you, sending my very heart." And so Paul writes to Philemon that he led Onesimus to the Lord, and now he is sending back to him. In verses 17 to 20 of Philemon, Paul writes, "So if you consider me your partner, Philemon, receive him, receive Onesimus, as you would receive me. If he has wronged you at all or owes you anything, charge that to my account. I, Paul, write this with my own hand. I will repay it, to say nothing of your owing me even your own self. Yes, brother, I want some benefit from you in the Lord. Refresh my heart in Christ." And so here, Paul is asking Philemon to forgive Onesimus and to restore him now that he is a repentant, faithful brother in the Lord Jesus Christ. And so Onesimus was the traveling companion of Tychicus as he brought this letter. Next, in verses 10 to 11, Paul, in his concluding remarks, sends greetings from three Jewish fellow workers who were with him in Rome. These three men are Jewish, and they're fellow workers with Paul, and they are with Paul, and they tell Paul, "Paul, tell the Colossians we said hi. Send greetings to them from us." And so in verses 10 and 11, Paul writes, "Aristarchus," here's the Aristarchus we saw in the book of Acts, "my fellow prisoner greets you, and Mark, the cousin of Barnabas, concerning whom you have received instructions. If he comes to you, welcome him. And Jesus, who is called Justice. These are the only men of the circumcision among my fellow workers for the kingdom of God, and they have been a comfort to me." And so here, Paul writes that these three men, Aristarchus, John Mark, and Jesus, who is called Justice, send their greetings. Let's look at these three men briefly. Aristarchus, we already saw, he was one of the men who accompanied Paul on the journey from Corinth to Jerusalem to deliver the offering. In Acts 19:29, it tells us this about Aristarchus, that he was with Paul in Ephesus on the third missionary journey. And this was when the silversmiths rose up to persecute Paul because he was putting them out of business. And it says in Acts 19:29, so the city was filled with the confusion. They rushed together into the theater, dragging with them Gaius and who? Aristarchus. They were Macedonians who were Paul's companions in travel. And so Aristarchus was one of his traveling companions. He was Jewish, even though he had a Greek name. This was his Greek name. And when they were in Ephesus, he was dragged into the theater by the people when they were angry at Paul. Not only that, we see Aristarchus again in Acts 27, verse 2. This is when they're going to sail from Caesarea to Rome for Paul's trial. And Luke writes this in Acts 27, verse 2. And embarking in a ship of Adramidium, which was about to sail to the ports along the coast of Asia, Luke writes, we put to sea accompanied by Aristarchus, a Macedonian from Thessalonica. And so here we see, even on that journey to Rome where they suffered shipwreck, Luke was with Paul and Aristarchus was with him. And so this Aristarchus was a Jewish believer from Thessalonica. Perhaps he got saved when Paul went there on the second missionary journey and preached the gospel, but he was a faithful companion of Paul. And now Aristarchus is saying hi to the Colossians. But not only Aristarchus, we see John Mark. Going back to verses 10 and 11, it says, and Mark, the cousin of Barnabas. Now, this Mark is the author of the Gospel of Mark. He's called John Mark in the New Testament. And John Mark was the cousin of Barnabas, who accompanied Paul on the first missionary journey. And John Mark is a very, very interesting character in the New Testament because he is an example to us of a believer who had a spiritual failure in his life and yet rebounded and went on to be a faithful servant of the Lord. So even if we have a failure in our spiritual life, that doesn't mean the Lord is done with us. We need to repent. The Lord picks us up and puts us back into the ministry. John Mark had this failure on the first missionary journey. You remember that Paul and Barnabas were sent out by the church of Antioch to the first missionary journey. Acts chapter 13, verse 5 tells us this. When they arrived at Salamis, they proclaimed the word of God in the synagogues of the Jews, and they had John to assist them. That's John Mark. So John Mark was with them to assist them on the first missionary journey. But down in verse 13, it tells us, Paul and his companions set sail for Paphos, came to Perga in Pamphylia, and John left them and returned to Jerusalem. Well, in the middle of the journey, for whatever reason, John Mark left Paul and Barnabas and went back home to Jerusalem. We don't know the details, but it was so serious in the sight of Paul that when they decided to go on the next missionary journey, Paul did not want to take John Mark. Do you remember that? In chapter 15, verses 38 and 39, it says that Paul thought best not to take with them one who had withdrawn from them in Pamphylia and had not gone on with them to the work. We don't want to take John Mark. He let us down last time. He'll probably do it again. And there arose a sharp disagreement so that they separated from each other. Barnabas took Mark, his cousin, with him and sailed away to Cyprus, whereas Paul took Silas and they went on. And so Paul did not want to take, he didn't trust John Mark to continue on because of his failure. And yet, here in Colossians, Paul writes that if Mark comes to you, receive him. And in 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 11, Paul wrote this, Luke alone is with me. Get Mark and bring him with you. Why? For he is very useful for me for ministry. So John Mark, even though he had a failure early in his ministry, Paul now writes that he is very useful for me. Bring him back. And so, beloved, if you have a failure in your Christian life or in your Christian ministry, don't allow that to prevent you from coming back, because the Lord is not done with you yet. And we all can get that second chance and third chance to follow and serve the Lord. So that was John Mark. But there was one other third Jewish believer with Paul in Rome. Now again, we see in verse 11, it says, and Jesus, who is called Justus. Now, we don't know anything about this man. Only thing we do know is that if your name was Jesus in those days, you did not go by that name. You were called something else. Just like nobody whose name was Judas would go by Judas. They would have a different name. So if your name was Jesus as a believer, you would choose another name. And so they called this man Jesus, or Joshua. They called him Justus. And again, we don't know anything about him, but he was a Jewish believer with Paul, saying greetings to the Colossians. And so these are the only men of the circumcision, meaning they were Jewish, among my fellow workers for the kingdom of God, and they have been a comfort to me. So after the greetings from Aristarchus, John Mark, and Justus, we see in verses 12 to 13 that Epaphras, remember, Epaphras was their pastor. He is the one who had preached the gospel to them. He was with Paul in Rome. Now he wants to make sure that he sends greetings also. And so in Ephesians 4:12, Paul writes, Epaphras, who is one of you, like Onesimus, he was a Colossian, he is a servant of Christ Jesus, he greets you, always struggling on your behalf in his prayers, that you may stand mature and fully assured in all the will of God. For I bear him witness that he has worked hard for you and for those in Laodicea and in Hierapolis. And so here we see Epaphras, who had come to Rome and told Paul about the situation in Colossae. He was still laboring on their behalf fervently through his prayers for them. He was praying that the Colossians would stand mature and fully assured in all the will of God. And so we can have a ministry in people's lives, even if we're separated from them, through our prayer life for them. And Paul says, I bear him witness. He's worked hard. He's labored hard through prayer for you and for those in Laodicea and Hierapolis, those three cities there. And again, we've seen that Epaphras was one of them. You remember in Colossians 1, verses 7 and 8? Talking about the gospel, Paul wrote, just as you learned it from Epaphras, our beloved fellow servant, he is a faithful minister of Christ on your behalf and has made known to us your love in the Spirit. And so Epaphras was their pastor. He was ministering to them faithfully when he was with them, and now he is ministering to them through praying for them. And Epaphras also sent greetings. Two other men that were with Paul at this time, that also sent their greetings, were Luke and Demas. Verse 14, Paul writes, Luke, the beloved physician, greets you, as does Demas. And so Luke, Paul's beloved physician, traveling companion, was still with him by his side, encouraging him. Luke, the author of the Gospel of Luke and the book of Acts. By the way, Luke was finishing up his writing of the book of Acts at this time. And so he was greeting them. And also Demas. Now, Demas is the flip side of John Mark. With John Mark, we saw a believer who stumbled in his ministry, and he was restored and become very faithful. Demas is the opposite. Demas here is with Paul. And Paul doesn't write anything negative. Apparently Demas was there, a believer, ministering with Paul, encouraging Paul. And yet, in 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 10, written a couple of years later, Paul writes, "For Demas, in love with this present world, has deserted me and gone to Thessalonica." And so Demas is the warning to us that just because we're faithfully serving the Lord right now, just because we're walking with the Lord right now, if any man thinks he stand, let him take heed lest he fall. Demas, later on, forsook Paul. Why? Because he loved this present world. He forsook his commitment to the Lord and loved the things of this world. And so he left Paul and was on his way to Thessalonica for some worldly reason. And so, beloved, we have John, Mark, and Demas who are examples to us. One, that we can have a failure and then come back, but also the other, that we can be following the Lord today, but fall in love with the things of this world tomorrow. And so we want to make sure that we remain steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord. So that was the greetings from Luke and Demas. And then in verses 15 to 17, we see three final commands that Paul gives to the Colossians. He says, "Give my greetings to the brothers at Laodicea," one of the sister cities of Colossae. "Give my greetings to the brothers at Laodicea and to Nympha and the church in her house. And when this letter has been read among you, have it also read in the church of the Laodiceans, and see that you also read the letter from Laodicea. And say to Archippus, see that you fulfill the ministry that you have received in the Lord." So here's three final commands. The first one we see, again in verse 15, is give greetings to the brothers at Laodicea. Again, when the Colossians interacted with the believers in the next town, he says, give them greetings. And to one woman in particular, who apparently had a house church in Laodicea, this woman named Nympha and the believers that meet with her. So Paul wanted to make sure that greetings went to the Laodicean church and to Nympha and the church in her house. A second command was to exchange letters with the Laodiceans. He says, when this letter, the letter of Colossians, has been read among you, someone, probably Archippus, would stand up, gather the whole church in Colossae together, and he would read out loud this letter to them. He says, when this letter has been read among you, have it also read in the church of the Laodiceans. So Colossians was not meant only for the Colossians. It was also meant for the Laodiceans originally, and it's meant for us too. And so when this letter has been read among you, have it also read in the church of the Laodiceans, and see that you also read the letter from Laodicea. Now, what letter is this? What letter was going to come from Laodicea that they were to read? Well, we don't know for sure. Some Bible teachers believe that this was the letter to the Ephesians. Some think that Ephesians was not written just to the church of Ephesus, but it was a cyclical letter that was passed around the churches in Asia Minor. It's a possibility, but we don't know for sure. But whether it was Ephesians or some other letter, Paul wanted to make sure that the Colossians read his letter, made sure that it was read by the Laodiceans, and then also they received the letter from Laodicea and read it amongst them. And so exchange letters with the Laodiceans. And the last one, verse 17 of these three final commands, he addresses Archippus. And he says to say to Archippus, see that you fulfill the ministry that you have received in the Lord. So apparently when Epaphras left Colossae, Archippus was the man who led the church in the absence of Epaphras. And Paul says, fulfill the ministry you have received in the Lord. Apparently, Archippus was to take over the lead in the preaching of the Word of God over the church there. We read about Archippus in Philemon verses 1 and 2. Again, he says, Paul, a prisoner of Christ Jesus, and Timothy, our brother, to Philemon, our beloved fellow worker, and Apphia, our sister, and Archippus, our fellow soldier, and the church in your house. So apparently, Apphia was Philemon's wife, and most likely, Archippus was Philemon's son. And they had the church, part of the Colossian church, met in Philemon's house. And so Paul is writing to Philemon, to Apphia, and to Archippus. And this Archippus apparently was the pastor and the leader while Epaphras was gone. And so Paul writes, make sure you exhort Archippus to fulfill the ministry you have received in the Lord. Fulfill it. Don't just occupy the office. Don't just have the title. Do the work. Fulfill the ministry that you have received in the Lord. And then finally, verse 18, the last verse, we see Paul's final greeting and blessing that he bestows on the Colossians. He writes, I, Paul, writing this greeting with my own hand, remember my chains. Grace be with you. Paul normally would dictate his letters, and he would have someone as his secretary who would write it. But often at the end of the epistle, Paul would take the pen out of the hand of his secretary, and with his own hand, he would write the final greeting to authenticate the letter so that they would know it was truly from him. And so he says, I, Paul, write this greeting with my own hand. We see the same thing in Galatians chapter 6, verse 11, where Paul again, at the end of writing Galatians, took the pen out of the hand of his secretary, and he says, see with what large letters I am writing to you with my own hand. And so Paul did this again to authenticate the letter that it was truly from him. And so going back to verse 18, he says, I, Paul, write this greeting with my own hand. Remember my chains. Colossians, don't forget me. Continue to pray for me. Remember my chains. And then his final blessing, very short, very sweet. Grace. May God's grace, his divine enablement, his unmerited favor be with you in your life and in the life of your church. And so, beloved, with these final exhortations concerning prayer, concerning witness to unbelievers, and with these concluding marks, the Apostle Paul brings the letter of Colossians to a close. What a marvelous, marvelous epistle with wonderful truths for us to understand and live by. Now, next Sunday is the fifth Sunday of the month. It's going to be Missions Emphasis Sunday. Mark Abeles, a friend of mine, a former student of mine, who is a missionary to Muslims with Frontiers Ministry, will be here. And Mar will be talking to you about missions, in particular toward Muslims. And he's got a video, excellent video to show concerning missions. And so Mark Abeles will be here next week. And afterward, in November, we're planning on starting a new series. Before Christmas, we want to do 4 weeks on the 6 days of creation. We're going to be looking at Genesis chapter 1 and the beginning of chapter 2 for 4 weeks, for 4 Sundays. And we're going to be studying about when God created the heavens and the earth. And so, Colossians, again, let's live our lives in light of these wonderful truths. Let's pray. Father, thank you for your word this morning. Thank you that even in these final exhortations and concluding remarks by the Apostle Paul, we have clear instructions on how we are to live our lives. And Lord, we pray that you might help us as individual believers be men and women of prayer, both individually and as a church in corporate prayer. Help us to walk in wisdom toward unbelievers that we meet. May our speech toward them be always gracious, gentle, and effective in witnessing for you. We thank you for these different men that were with the Apostle Paul and that were an encouragement to him, and pray that you might help us to imitate them, that we too might be faithful servants of yours. Thank you for John Mark as an example that even when we stumble, even when we fall, that doesn't mean we're no longer able to be used by you, but as we repent, you're gracious, you forgive, and you restore. And Lord, I pray that you might help none of us to be like Demas, but may we faithfully follow you and serve you all the days of our life. Father, we give you all the praise and glory, and we thank you for our study in Colossians in Jesus' name. Amen.